गुड मॉर्निंग। ऐसा मत सुना। गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू, वेलकम यू ऑल टू डे फोर सेशन। आई एम ग्लैड टू इंट्रोड्यूस टुडेज फोर नॉन सेशन फैसिलिटेटर डॉक्टर रिजो जैक्सन टॉम, प्रोफेसर एट सीएमआर इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी बैंगलोर। He did his Doctor of Philosophy in School of Computing at SRM Institute of Science and Technology in July 2016. He did Master of Engineering in Applied Electronics at Sathyabhama Institute of Science and Technology, Chennai in the year 2011-13 with a CGPA 8.84, University 5th rank. He was first class and distinction candidate in the M.Tech. Bachelor of Engineering in Electronics and Instrumentation, Faculty of Electrical Engineering at Sri Ramakrishna Engineering College, Coimbatore, with a percentage of 77, first class with a distinction. He has numerous number of publication. As per Google Scholar Index citation 123, H Index 5, I10 Index 4, cumulative impact factor he holds 17.921. He is a reviewer of IEEE Internet of Things, High Impact Factor Journal, IEEE Access, High Impact Factor Journal, IEEE Selected Areas in Communication, High Impact Factor Journal, Advances in System Science and Application, IGA Global. Hedo has several patents, secured intelligent IoT-based SCADA for power distribution automation, provisional patent application for smart energy management and demand reduction in IoT fog-based power distribution system, an IoT fog-based power distribution for smart energy management and a method, industrial designs filed patent is in progress, and a blockchain-based e-voting system for India in association with DRDO. Several projects are in progress. One of the project is blockchain-based e-voting system for India in association with DRDO, renewable energy prediction and energy smart energy management by DST Texas Instrument Projects, and drone loss hope, and IoT-based transformer healthcare monitoring system, internet of vehicles, return to my homeland, waste management system for smart cities. These are all the ongoing projects right now he holds. And industry consultancy he used to do for textile industry and motor generators. For the textile industry, computer vision based automatic bobbin sorter, Simta Jacobi, Coimbatore. Computer vision based automatic NEPS calculator, Eureka Textiles Private Limited, Coimbatore. And motor stator and rotor inspection using computer vision, Texmo Industry, Coimbatore. Lot of prototypes, hardware prototypes he has developed as well. Intelligent IoT based agriculture monitoring system, intelligent IoT based water quality monitoring system, IoT based smart garbage system, IoT based smart energy system, wireless electricity in daily utilities, wireless electricity billing system using Zigbee, automatic paddy crop monitoring system using Zigbee, light fidelity using Arduino, remote aquaculture monitoring using wireless sensor networks, a novel heavy vehicle overload detector. This is also filed for a patent. Lot of scholarship and prizes, merits are awarded to our today's resource person. Finalist in Mitsubishi Electric Cup 2020, CMRIT off-premises asset management using IoTH, Best Project Guidance Award at the Kalaivani College of Technology 2014, Soldier Health Monitoring System using IoT, Best Project Award at the Kalaivani College of Technology in 2014, Soldier Health Monitoring System using IoT, Best Poster Presentation Award at AISGSC 2019, Multi-Agent Based Smart Energy Management in IoT Fog-Based Power Distribution System. He do have a lot of awards and certification with respect to co-curricular appreciation, poetry completion, painting competition. He is having academic experience of 6 years and 2 years of industrial experience. He is volunteering to several NGOs as well. It's my great pleasure in welcoming you, sir. I request you to handle the session on IoT edge computing in smart cities. Welcome you all. Welcome you, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
One second. Is my voice audible?
Yes, perfect, sir. Perfect. I will stop sharing it. You can continue with your presentation, sir.
Okay, one second. Just hold a minute.
Sure, sir.
I'll just connect one second.
Yeah, sure, sir. We are waiting.
So, one second, I'm sorry that my video won't be visible. My laptop has a small issue with the video. Maybe I'll just try it. It's upside down, right?
It's visible, sir, but it's upside down.
Yeah, fine, yeah. Now is it visible?
No, sir. Presentation is not yet shared, I guess, sir.
Yeah, presentation not. Is my video visible now?
No, sir. No, sir. It's off only. Video okay. Is off.
Okay. No issues. At least.
Presentation is visible, sir. Maybe we need to put it in the full screen mode. That's all.
No?
Yes, sir. Perfect, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. So, yeah. So, good morning to one and all present. Okay, I have participants here. Yeah, fine. So anyway, thanks for the introduction, ma'am. So that was quite long, but okay, let's see. well, as ma'am introduced, and thanks for the great introduction about me. And so basically, I know that today we are having a very good session for the past few days, correct? So we had a lot of information from people from industry and from NIT. I hope they have all given a good amount of introduction regarding all these subjects. And so today we have around like 2 hours, 2.5 hours going forward. But what I would like to say from the beginning is that I would like to have you people interact with me. And especially if you are able to talk to me then and there, I think so we will have a good session today. Because one thing what I understand always is that knowledge is not just from one person. So when there are participants over there, everyone has or learned a lot of things. So it is for even for the speaker, it is a kind of a learning from the others. And when we talk, we interact a lot and we come to know that what all you have learned in the past few sessions also. So I would also like to know that. Unfortunately, I was not able to attend the past few sessions, but I would like to know from you what you people have learned also. Hope that should be fine. Yes, anyone can at times turn on their mic and say yes or no like that. So we will have some voices from the audience side also. Even the others will feel that, okay, they are attending something like a good session. Yes. Hope all are listening, correct? Let me look into the chats also once in a while. So that's also yes. Okay, fine, good. Yeah, I'll look into the chat side by side so that we can't. Okay. We can't unmute. Okay, fine, fine. Okay, so then it should be, then I would prefer that you people keep chatting also once in a while. If you have doubts, as and when the session goes on, if you have doubts, I would prefer you people to chat on it. Okay.
Once half an hour or any intervention if you are giving could be unmuted, sir. They can even use audio note. Any okay. kind of question, interaction or kind of intervention if you are giving, then by that time it will be unmuted, sir.
Okay, so like that we can do. Okay, so if we will give time so that we can have an audio chat in between, correct?
Exactly, sir, exactly.
Okay, that should be very, very good. Okay, that's very fine from your side. It's well organized, thank you. So even at times also if people can put chat over here if you have any doubts on these things. So I'll tell you beforehand itself, the PPTs which will go over here will only have images. Most of the time, 99% of my PPTs will be only photographs. So we'll be talking more. So it will be better if you people will be listening more. And then later on, I will share you all the things which we were discussing also. Yeah. So today's session, as I would like to thank Dr. Pichai sir for inviting me for this session. And for this great event that is happening, and it is my pleasure to be with you today. So it gives me immense happiness also to be a part of this, and especially to share some of the knowledge which I have gained throughout these years working on these aspects to you people. So I would love when you people also start learning things and knowing things and start working on such great things for the better world tomorrow. So that will be our main aim. What we will take away today is that a good amount of knowledge, okay, a very good amount of knowledge, as much as possible, and try to implement all these things in our day-to-day lives, okay? So let's see how effective these few hours is going to be. Yes, as today's topic we'll be discussing is Internet of Things and Edge Computing in Smart Cities. So our primary focus will be on something called as Smart Cities, a concept which the government of India is also focusing on to build up cities and making them smart, and especially using a few technologies called Internet of Things and Edge Computing. Can I know how many of you and this people who are participating know about Edge Computing? You can just put in the chat if you know. Okay, I just wanted to know how many people know about it. Yes, okay. So kindly give a response. Depending on that, it'll be helpful for me to take forward the session also.
Participants, I have unmuted. If you wish, you can come with the audio note also. If you don't feel comfortable with the chat window, you can come with audio. Now you can unmute and you can communicate.
Yes, ma'am. Very good morning. Actually, edge computing is nothing but whenever the devices, decentralized computing happens nearby the devices, like in the edge of the, like, system, whenever small computing to avoid traffic in the cloud, that is actually okay, edge okay. computing. Yes,
ma'am. Yeah, thank you. Very good from your side. So others, if you are new to this, okay, we will have the session where we will concentrate on that aspect also, because I'll be covering portions on edge computing. So people can note those things also. Yeah, very good. Fine. Okay, let's go forward. Uh, Now, can you people tell me what you learned from this last few days? What do you understand? What did you understand from what Internet of Things was? I find a lot of people, I know that there is a lot of good sessions that has taken place. So kindly, please, can you just share with me a few minutes? Yes, like as to
yes,
what
sir,
you
actually,
understand.
I found that IoT is nothing but communication between two devices with or without intervention of human being. So yet majority has come to on the technology, but actually IoT is nothing but Internet of Things where things are going to communicate with each other.
Okay. How about others, like participants? Please, can you just share with me what do you learn from the last few days?
Sir, as a host, may I summarize? Because I'm not sure how many of them continuously attended all the session without missing. As per ACT norms, around 75% to 80% attendance is sufficient. So because of that, they would have missed a couple of sessions. That is for sure. I can assure that none of them attended to the 100%, I guess. We started with the inauguration. The chief guest demonstrated a lot of use cases. Coming to the day one session, the complete overview of Internet of Things, architecture, hardware architecture, that stack and software stack, the types of protocol, how the communication is happening, what are all the major components, that are purely theory on based on theory, the day one. Then day two morning, it is of complete architecture and hardware and protocols required for each and every architecture and types of communication, like I have RFID communication, Wi-Fi communication, LoRa, that kind of what are all the way we can get connected with the devices and things. And coming to the subsequent session, communication, how it happens, MQTT protocol is mainly touched upon with one demonstration, rest all of the protocols given the idea, theoretical. Okay. Then afternoon, complete Arduino Thinkercad demonstration with four projects or five projects, I'm not sure. So that is projects with the code and that cloud platform, the resource person was demonstrating. Okay. Coming to the next session, yesterday morning session, IoT storage options, completely what are all the available DBs available. Depending upon the use case, whether they need to choose time series or Hadoop ecosystem, or they need to go for cloud platforms, AWS, Azure, or what kind of that holistic picture of data storage. Based on the data type, data, whatever the velocity, veracity, these all the component and type of the device and the type of the data flow, everything, how to choose the data reservoir or warehouse. That is what completely yesterday's morning discussion. And coming to afternoon, how we need to secure that IoT web security, both of the session was full of theory rather than I can say hands-on. So they had brought the complete picture of how to be handling with data with respect to data and with respect to security concerns. This is what the journey happened so far now. Today we are stepping into edge computing. However, they had given definitions, couple of resource persons given the definition for edge computing. There is no bigger insight has been given and the coding has been given. And today edge computing, subsequently IoT robotic arm, this is what the session planned. And how exactly IoT is useful for renewable energy resources. So these are all the complete picture of this STTP.
Okay, wonderful, excellent, ma'am. So it is like once this person, any person who is attending this training program will have a holistic picture on everything what is required for developing a system. So basically what we will, that's a wonderful takeaway which people have taken forward. So today what we'll be focusing on is on smart cities, right? So in smart cities, what are there? What I wish is, since you have got so much of idea, I wish that every participant should be now be able to look into different aspects of a city and what are the things are involved. So I wish, or I presume that there are students in this participants are there. There are faculty participants. There are people who are doctorates. There are people who are research scholars also. So I hope this few hours, what we'll take forward is, we will look into the different applications that are required into a smart city. And now I will prefer each one of you or someone in the participants itself to come forward as to what all is required for each problem statement. So we will, what we will do today is, we will look into the different problem domains that a city has. Okay, and based upon that, participants has to come out with a session. Okay, we will have support systems from the PPTs itself, but participants has to come forward and tell what is required to make a or define or help a problem to be solved. Okay, is that fine with everyone? Isn't that a better way to go, since you have 3 days have gone forward with a lot of information like MQTT protocol? So I am very much glad that nothing I need not take off MQTT or the QAP or other protocols which is required, LoRa, nothing. Correct. So now you people can now talk about directly about how to solve a particular problem that is faced inside a city. Okay, let's see how things goes forward. Okay, my assistants will be there and I will talk about edge computing also and how to make edge computing a very important part of a IoT based system. Okay, and how it is going to be useful. So I will only talk about it, maybe the links, everything. And let me ask you one more thing. How many of you have worked with Raspberry Pi?
Participants, it's unmuted. Anyone can unmute and communicate.
Yeah, please. So I would like to hear voices. I always prefer that. No problem. Yes, participants, if you have you heard of or have you worked with Raspberry Pi and Python? If you are convenient with that, it's going to be very much useful in your life.
Sir, a little bit. I started working on that.
Okay. Worked virtually with Raspberry Pi.
Yes, sir. Like initial stage. Raspberry Pi.
Okay, wonderful, wonderful. Other participants? Yeah.
And if you give enlightenment on Raspberry Pi, then it will work for
something. Okay, Raspberry Pi, maybe okay. I have not thought of that, but maybe in later time. But let's see how Raspberry Pi is useful. I will tell about that and Python programming. Because what we'll be primarily focusing on the electronics part, okay? Let's move forward and see. Okay.
There are few responses, sir. They say that worked virtually with Raspberry Pi and Thinkercad.
Thinkercad, wonderful. Yeah, I'm just looking into the chat also side by side, ma'am.
Yeah, that's fine, sir.
Yes, I would like participants to talk because that is way in which a speaker can always move forward in a good manner. Yes. Okay. So I have a picture in your slide right now. Can anyone tell what is that?
Sir, is it a bulb?
No, it's not.
Transmitter.
No, it's not a transmitter.
A replica of first translate is written on that only, sir.
Replica of a?
First transistor.
Yes, first transistor. So it's written over there. Yeah. What is this? So these are the
it's
three
signs.
Yeah, I know. It's written over there. Replica of the first transistor that was invented in Bell Laboratories in December 23, 1947. So what happened? The few inventions which has transformed the world today that we live in is this invention of the transistor, which has changed the whole world that we live in. Okay, and from the 50 years, we know the developments that we have. Every object that you have in your hand, from you are able to see the screen now, is only because of this particular invention, the invention of the transistor. Correct. So let's go behind a few things. We will introduce a few people also, personalities also, who are behind the top inventions of this world. And the next thing. So, can anyone tell me who this person was? Yes, anyone? So the person's, yeah?
Lack of awareness or no, sir, I don't know.
Integrated circuit, sir.
Integrated circuits, exactly. So this person's name is Jack Kilby, okay? So he was the person who was responsible for the invention of the integrated circuits. So he is also responsible for the invention of calculator. He is the person behind something called the thermal printer, the printer which comes with your ATM machines. And when you go to take a bus tickets, you have a printout coming out. That is called thermal printers. So he is the person behind that. So he is Jack Kilby. He was an engineer in Texas Instruments. So after 10 years of the invention of transistors was the invention of integrated circuits that has happened. And you know how IC chips are involved in our day-to-day lives till today. So the two most inventions I just wanted to showcase to you, because once in a while, it's always good to know that how our history has taken place. Our history was not for this development of computer science and this development of AI and ML. It was not a very 100 or 200 years old. It's just 50 years old. For the past 50 years is what we see all the developments that has happened in the world in a tremendous manner. Okay, so we have a few history behind where we have come forward within this past few decades, not only century old. So that is something which is really great and appreciated in this part, that we are developing very fast towards, and the world is going faster also. So as engineers, I hope that we all are proud to be engineers and we have a great role to play in this world that we live in today. Okay. Okay, then rest is history. So we know that after the integrated circuits was invented, then came our invention of the microprocessors and the microcontrollers. So then the companies like the Intel and the AMD were playing the most tremendous games, and they rule the world of processors and computers. So every laptops that you use, everything came with Intel or AMD processors. Now, then came the architecture of ARM processors, okay, advanced RISC machines. Okay, whereas your Intel architecture, all those things follows the CISC machines, and these are RISC machines. So reduced instruction set computers. So your ARM processors, and the ARM processors are low power and they are most widely used in all of your smartphones. So all of your smartphones comes up with a ARM based processing capability. And then comes your microcontrollers also. And nowadays with Python programming, any basic person from belonging to any group, not only computer engineers, people from electrical engineering, people from other fields, from civil or mechanical, a simpler programming language which could help anyone to develop anything in a very few time, or which made development very easier. So, and do it yourself projects was possible. It was only possible because of the introduction of such programming languages like Python and Arduino based boards. So we know that initially the embedded system based programming was very difficult. Even for a person working core in that should understand a lot in order to do a embedded based programming. Whereas why did Arduino and Raspberry Pi become much more easier for people to introduce? And there was a high boom in that was because of the easiness of programming a microcontroller board. See, as in, you know that I am from an electronics instrumentation background. And I have seen a lot of boards which we used to work with big microcontrollers and other things. But for myself, Arduino was much more simpler than I understood that anyone belonging to any domain could easily learn and start working on microcontroller programming. It made even school children start working on projects. So that much is a tremendous, for the past few years, world has changed tremendously based upon the inventions of these things. So why we are taking this introduction is these were the responsible or the reasons behind the development of the concepts of Internet of Things, connectivity, all those things were developed or became easy because of transistors, integrated circuits, the inventions of microcontroller and microprocessors, then these kinds of boards, which was helpful for anyone to start and do things. Okay. Now, okay, so how many of you knew that he is the person behind the Internet of Things? Okay, so we are talking about IoT, and this person, Kevin Ashton, he is the inventor of the term IoT. He is the father of IoT. Okay, so basically what has happened is in 1999, he was working with the labs, his particular company. And what he wanted to, or he described, was what Internet of Things should be. Okay. So that now it's all about computers. Okay. It's all about computers, and computers should be able to see, hear, smell the world that they live in. Okay. So remember these three terms. Today, what we'll be going forward is, we'll be learning these things, how to see or hear and smell the world that the computers are attached to. So how everything is going to get integrated, and how are we going to solve a particular problem that the world is going to face. So in today's perspective, for the next few hours, I request all of you to apply your mind. So an engineer's job is to apply their mind into a problem statement and to define a solution. Okay. So what we are going to do, today, we are taking up a problem. With that problem, we are going to apply our mind. Applying our mind, we are going to find out how to solve a particular problem. Okay. So this is how we will be moving forward. All that will be assisted by means of the slides. And I hope every one of them will take forward one of the projects that we look over here into their final year projects, or as their student projects, which has been moving forward, or as a research work that has been carried forward also. Okay. So this is what was Kevin Ashton's aim about computers. Now let's look into a smart city. So why do you call that city smart? The term smart comes because whenever a thing is being done by itself without human interventions, it is called as smart. Okay. Now what is called as a smart city? A city should be able to sustain itself by means of connecting a lot of sensors, okay, and communication devices and computers to do analytics, and everything should be automated. Okay. So this is the concept of smart in a city. Okay. Now let's see what all should happen, okay, in a city to make it smart. Okay. Now this is the picture given over here. Okay. Let's see and hear from our participants, what are the problems that a city faces? Okay. What are the problems that a city faces? I will also note down in the pen and paper. I'll note down what all you people say. Okay. And then we will start looking into different problem statements. Yes. Can you people see this picture? Okay. You can help make use of this picture also. And kindly tell me each and every domain where in a city, where all intervention of computer science and engineering is required to make a city smart. Yes. Can you people list out one by one? You can either type in the chat. I will note down those things, or else you can talk also. Yes. Can you tell me what are the problems that a city faces?
Please pardon that.
What are the problems? See, we are talking about a smart city, right? So in a smart city, what are the problem domains that requires, what are the problem domains that requires monitoring, control and smartness? Okay. So I need people to tell about the problems that we face in a city. See, garbages, then traffic jams,
sanitization, yeah. traffic jams,
then
parking. Controlling the traffic inside the city, parking.
Yeah, parking.
Medical facilities.
Medical facility, yeah, okay, medical facility.
Then
surveillance, yeah. Yes, ma'am, please. Surveillance. Karthikeyan sir has told about energy and water pollution. Wonderful.
Energy and water consumption.
Water consumption, okay. Water
conservation.
Monitoring. Yeah, water conservation. Yeah, then power cut. Yeah, power failure. So, okay, we'll deal about power.
Connectivity problems from the tower.
Okay, connectivity from the tower. Yeah, communication section, communications. Violation of traffic rules. Yeah, violation of connectivity between places. Connected to transportation. Yeah, we'll talk about transportation. Public transport infrastructure. Very good. Infrastructure. security. So security of the city, and even though whenever, so this is one part, doctor. What is the security as an aspect when we look into, that's a separate big domain which has to be taken care, especially when you're talking about Internet of Things. So when you talk about Internet of Things, once it is connected to the internet, you know that people can hack into it and take control over the whole things. So if you look into an aspect of where when you think of the whole city being connected to the internet, security is a very, very separate big domain that has to be taken care and has to be dealt in a separate manner. And this makes the cybersecurity a very important concept to be a part of IoT. And that's I don't have much knowledge on that aspect to share on security actually. And that is one of the important things which has to be added, which I feel, into the domain when we talk about Internet of Things, how to secure the whole system and what are the standards and protocols that they are bringing in while defining and the architecture for IoT. Is the security a part of the architecture is a very important thing that people are talking about, and the Internet Consortium is also discussing on those aspects. In what all ways is the present security enough to protect the whole infrastructure when we define IoT is thought about. Okay, so that is a separate very important domain that has to be taken care. Okay, probably let me check into the chats. Have we covered almost everything regarding that? Air pollution, yes, we are. We'll talk about that. Air pollution, power cut, rainwater control. So water management we'll talk about, because all cities, we are losing water nowadays. Water management is a very, very important aspect to be taken care. Every drop is very important nowadays. Drainage is, of course, drainage, traffic jam, garbage. Okay. So we have got a lot of problems now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So more than 15 problems, statements that we ourselves have thought about, which a city can actually face. Now, if you look into this diagram, one of the few things that we are missing is about the charging stations that we, because we have electrical vehicles coming up, and that infrastructure of electric vehicles, then bike stations, then did we miss anything? EV charging station, then public lighting. We talked about lighting, I think so. Did we talk about the smart lighting systems? Okay, maybe that thing was what. So we can, one more problem statement is a smart lighting system, especially during the night. The lighting systems is an important thing, and what all features we can bring into that is also very important. Okay, wonderful. Okay, now the city has enough problems. And what does the smart city concept talk about? Yes, there should be more control, there should be more security, more services, less energy usage, less traffic, and make decisions in a very, very best. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Smart city mainly consists of smart homes, which is actually a group of devices is going to make the city smart.
So I feel that smart homes.
A combination of smart homes, smart services, and smart manufacturing, if city is having any kind of.
Exactly. And smart homes is also a part of that. We will add smart homes also into the problem domains that we come across. One second. Yeah. Okay. So now let's look into each things one by one. And I wish that each one participate in this particular part. Okay. So some of the things which we will be looking into in a more detailed manner are these things. So one is a smart water management, traffic management, parking infrastructure, power distribution system, lighting, smart waste management, and one of the most important things, which, and many more which I have written, is because I just wanted from you people. One is pollution monitoring, because a smart city should be pollution free. We need good air to breathe. Okay, that is one of the important part which we should have. in the communication, then transportation between different places, smart transportation. Okay. Then one more thing is called as the Internet of Vehicles, IOV, which we'll be discussing. So these are some of the domains which is involved in a smart city. Okay. Now, so basically from the all these previous 3 days, you would have learned of these things. So the first layer is the sensing layer. Then you have the communication layer and the analytics layer. So from the next few minutes, when we talk about one particular problem domain, what we should do is we should first divide our mind into three parts. One is the sensing part. The next part is the communication part. Third part is the analysis part. Okay. So first we need to sense, then we need to communicate, and then we don't need to analyze and come up with a solution. So the next problem, any problem has to be divided into three parts. Okay. And we will have come up with a solution for a problem. Okay. This is what we are going to do today. So sensing is nothing but from your childhood, from your sixth standard till your lifetime, you have studied physics. So it's basically physics. Okay. And you are converting all the physical parameters into electrical signals. Can anyone tell me why do you want to convert any signal into electrical signal? It's a very basic and a simple question which I'm asking. And why should you convert any physical for processing? Okay. So why especially electrical signal processing and controlling? Because simply because our controlling part is nothing but done by computers, and computers require digital signals. So whatever is the physical parameters that is available, we need to convert all those things into electrical signals, and from the electrical signal, yes, exactly, to understand by a computer. The only the electrical signals, and then from there to a digital or analog. You always have every microcontroller board has an analog to a digital converter, which converts that, okay, into digital forms. Okay, so very good. Then you have the communication part. Okay, once you sense it, you get the data, you put it into a microcontroller. Now it's in bits. Now this bits has to be transmitted to a long distance or to a cloud or to your own monitor system where you need all these things. And how it is being sent? By means of communications. And we have n number of communication systems that is available as on date, correct? So we have Bluetooth, and especially our own mobile phones have Wi-Fi and Bluetooth by default. Okay. Some mobile phones also has our NFC, near field communications. Okay, so Bluetooth, we have always seen Bluetooth, how it functions. Wi-Fi also people have seen. Then ZigBee, we know. Then we have worked with 2G, 3G, 4G is what we are using. So we know the effectiveness of those things. And other than that, there are a few more communication protocols. There is a LoRa, Sigfox, or the narrowband Internet of Things. So this one picture should be kept in your mind. Okay, as to what I should use for a particular application. So it's about choosing things correctly, which makes a proper solution for your problem. So first, anything that you have, you should have a problem. There are a lot of problems in the world, day-to-day life that you see. Anything that you look into should be looked into as a problem, and how to solve that, you apply your engineering brain into it. Okay. And the knowledge that you gained or what all you see over here, you apply that into the problem domain. Okay. And provide a solution. Okay, so one such person is what I'm going to introduce in the next slide, is this particular person. So how many of you have seen this person before or known about this person before? So we're talking about a world of 5G that's coming up, and in today's everyone is using either a Wi-Fi or in your home, or a 4G in your house, and you are seeing this particular presentation from here, from somewhere in one corner I am presenting, and everyone is able to see it. It was possible only because of this particular person. Okay, this person's name is Arogyasamy Paulraj. Okay, he was an Indian from Tamil Nadu. Okay, he was working in India. He was working with the Navy. And then he had established enough labs over here, but he went to Stanford as a professor in the year 1991, and 1992 he files a patent for the concept called as MIMO, It is multiple input and multiple output, okay, which forms the basics for your Wi-Fi or 4G or 5G, whatever it is, whichever is the basic thing or the invention which is required for the communication that we do now. The multiple input and the multiple output concept is the his invention. And Indian from South India, okay. And so let's be proud that we have people, Indians, working on all these wireless technologies. You should understand, even with wireless communication systems and wireless sensor networks, the most of the protocols that they define, we Indians had hand in that, okay. What are protocols that you come across, a leech and all those things, were Indians were the persons who are the brain behind those traffic management systems. Okay, so I just wanted to introduce this person because I recently only came to know about this person. So I make it a point that whichever presentation I give, I make sure that I showcase these things, because as Indians, we should be proud that we have done a lot of work on such systems for the world. Okay, so after communication is the analytics part. So analytics, we have, as a computer science people, almost everyone would have studied about Hadoop, the storage systems, the databases, then the analytics engines, the AI and the ML systems, which is required to work on data. Okay, so this analytics part comes only when the data is received in a database. Okay, so you see the overall flow, that there is a physical parameter. Physical parameter is converted to an electrical parameter. The electrical parameter is then converted to a bitwise data by means of a computer. From there, it has been transmitted using any different protocols, which is having defined with n different standards and protocols. And it finally reaches a place where it has been stored. And when you have a lump amount of data, what you do, you analyze it to derive insights out of it. Once you derive insights, you can take decisions, okay, or you can improve decisions, or you can take decisions for the future. So all these things are possible only if you have data in hand. So the most important part is that you cannot have any random data. Okay, the first and foremost thing, which is most important and the most ignored part, which I feel in any of the IoT based presentations, is the part of sensing itself. People, because what happens, this was a IoT is not a domain of one particular department or things. It is a culmination of n number of departments. To be frank, what I suggest is that all departments should work together to work on IoT based systems, because you cannot leave out civil department, because you do not know how the water flow. For example, if you are working at the water management system, a computer science department will not know how the water flow is there. What is the flow rate? How a water will flow in a pipe? What is the diameter of the pipe? And for this diameter of the pipe, what kind of sensor should be attached? It is not. We are not expertise in that. Whereas the civil department is very much expertise in those levels. So whenever you talk about a system or you want to implement an IoT-based solutions, it's always better to work with a interdisciplinary part itself. Work with people with civil, with mechanical. You need mechanical people to work on a lot of things, and you need every department to come together, at least to have students from different departments come together to work on one particular solution, so that one particular problem you have, so that you have a better solution. For example, our own understanding on different subjects will be different. So that is one part which I always used to insist. Please work interdisciplinary, so that we have, at the end of the day, a good fruit out of our hard work. Okay, so first we will talk about a smart water management system itself. Now it's time for us to put our minds into this particular problem. We have a water system. Okay, now our thing is how to provide a smart water management system. Now what all are the requirements needed? Now we have a problem. We have a water system in the city. Now we need to make the water system smart. Now tell me first, we are going to define the IoT based.
Overflow wastage is stopped now, sir. So much of water could be saved at a home, at a city, that a corporation tank, everywhere overflow is happening. That is controlled itself, so much of saving would happen.
Okay, Okay, so that's what. So one is the overflow that ma'am talks about. There is an overflow of wastage of water is there. Now we are talking about this water management system. Yes, please, from the participants.
But manual irrigation, at the time of irrigation, so much of water is... Sir, when we go for irrigation, if irrigation will be smarter, at that time, a small amount of water is going to be used as compared to the traditional way. Okay. There we can save lots of water, as well as in manufacturing also the same thing is happening.
Okay, so now we have a problem called as quantity of water. Okay, quantity of water is one thing which talking about. Yes, please, others also. Now what I want to know is that now we have, what are the problems that we face in water distribution systems? So one was the quantity of water that is being wasted. Yeah, next.
Overconsumption of underground water.
Overconsumption. Okay, that's what. So we are talking about the quantity of water itself. So that is one concern which has to be monitored. Correct. So the quantity of water has to be monitored. Then. So you can look into this particular diagram. So this diagram talks about a lot of things. So one thing.
So monitoring on water supply.
Monitoring on water supply of water. Yeah, supply. Then.
Then sewerage treatment.
No, let's
and
not.
Water sewerage treatment as it is a treatment plant.
Yeah. Okay. The sewage treatment. There are two different things. Water treatment is different from water sewage treatment. So STP is a different separate section. We will talk about water reuse. Water treatment sticking to government standards. So water treatment, it is a quality of water.
Then rainwater harvesting.
Rainwater harvesting. Okay, we'll talk about rainwater harvesting. One thing is we should be aware of water resource and use it. Stop the waste of water, should be able to storage of water. Okay, storage of water. Storage. Yeah.
Reuse of water.
Pressure of water that is being pressure. Pressure of water that will flowing. Okay. Has to be monitored. So we'll talk about water things has to be monitored now.
Reuse of water?
Yeah, reuse is a solution. Okay. Reuse is a solution. What I'm asking now is apply your brain. Okay. Apply our brains. Our engineering brains has to be put into this problem of water system. And now we are going to think water should be measured so that we are able to save water. Okay, so we were talking about the quantity of water was the important thing, and we should stop overflowing or we should stop the leakage of water. So one thing is leakage detection and pressure control. So pressure of water and leakage. Okay, these two are important thing, because when we detect the pressure and things, we can are able to do that. Okay. Yes. Okay, let's look into this picture now. So for a water distribution system, the important parts that we should look into are your water is coming from a big river or a tank or a borewell. Now when you bring that water out, you need to measure the amount of water that you are taking in. Okay, so one is the quantity of water that has to be measured. Next is the quality of the water that has to be measured. So you should know what is the pH value has to be measured, the conductivity, okay, of the water that has to be measured. You people can note down these things, the conductivity that has to be measured. Okay, then the TDS value. Okay, the total dissolved solvents value, the TDS value has to be measured. So why I am talking about these things, these are the input parameters that has to go into a system so as to develop a better water management system. So quantity of water, then the TDS, conductivity and the pH. Okay, now once you do that, so next is the asset management. Asset is nothing but your pipelines. So you need to monitor the pipelines for any leakages or pressure control. So one more thing, parameter that we measured is pressure. So now I will list out what all are the things that we are going to look into. We are going to look into the pressure. We are going to measure the flow. Then we are going to measure the TDS. Then we will be measuring what is called as the pH value. Then we require TDS. So anyone who is going to work next on a water distribution system can look into all these parameters: pressure, flow, TDS, pH, and TDS, total dissolved solvents. Okay. And now, how do we measure pressure? So can anyone tell me what are the what do you require to measure pressure?
Barometer, sir.
Okay, barometer. Yeah. So barometer does a what we are going to work on, what is called as a water pressure. Okay. Sensors. So we are going to now talk about sensors. So in that sensors, we require pressure sensors for measuring water pressure. Barometer measures the atmospheric pressure. Okay. So now we need to look. We have looked into the problem domains. We need what all the parameters that we looked into. So now is the sensors that we're going to take is water pressure sensor. So this is nothing but the orifices. So orifice or venturimeters can be helped. Okay. Orifice. Then flow meters. Then what we require, one more thing which we forgot, was the level sensors. In water distribution system, another important part is here, level sensor. Okay, we have storage tanks. We need to understand the level of it, how to avoid overflow. So it is by means of level sensors, up to what level water is there. So up to what level water has been consumed. All these things are possible with respect to, with the help of level sensors. So the two important parts for water level and flow is your level sensor. So I am showing you the pictures for this. I will send you a separate document as to the Amazon links where you can look for all these things also. So this particular picture, what you see on the left hand side is your level sensor. Okay, on the right hand side is your flow sensor. Okay. So whenever you can look into the hardware part, you can look into the sensor part itself. Okay. So this is also one more of the another type of flow sensor which is used, which is called as a DPT. Okay, this is a differential pressure transducer. Okay, the image that you see is called as a differential pressure transducer. So whenever water is flowing, the water pressure is the most important part. Okay, based upon that only you can define a water distribution system. So I am showing you the important sensors that are involved in that. Okay, so whenever you see this, okay, I can understand that it's a pressure sensor. There are magnetic type pressure sensors, the magnetic pickup types are there, then differential pressure types are also available. Then now that you have, now you have what is called as a TDS meter, you have a pH meter and a conductivity meter. Now all those things can be connected to your, now what should you do once you have the sensors with you? What is the next part to be done?
Connectivity.
But let me ask you one more thing. I showed you a picture on the previous slide. Yes. Is this flow meter enough for all kinds of fluids? All water pipes, is this particular sensor enough?
Diameter varies from pipelines, sir.
Diameter varies. Does the system also varies? Okay, so you know that the pressure varies. When the pipe size is bigger, the pressure of the pipe is also bigger. Okay, so pressure that comes out of the water that comes out also is, you cannot use the same kind of sensors for every different places or every different situation also. So this is also an important factor that has to be checked into, which is called as the range, okay, and the response of your sensors. Why I am insisting on this thing is, we know to do data analytics. Data analytics is very easy compared to computer science people nowadays, because we have a lot of tools and Python programming that is already available in order to do machine learning and things. But what if your data that is coming out is wrong? So the very, very most important part to be taken care is in the terms of the data that has been generated itself. See, connectivity, Bluetooth has a well-defined protocol till date. Wi-Fi has a well-defined method in which the data has to be transmitted. So generally we can assume that Wi-Fi does not does any error. The data, when it is transmitted or received, the data is not wrong. Okay, when I talk, what I talk is exactly what you hear. It means that my Wi-Fi protocol has exactly worked correctly. When I talk, what, when I tell what, you all listen to what, you don't listen how. Okay, it is because the protocol, the wirelessly, all the data that has been transmitted is being transmitted effectively, and everyone receives it exactly the same way. So we are very much sure about the connectivity part. But what if I give my data wrong? So that is the most important part, which I feel with my experience, is that if you have a wrong data, all your analytics is wrong. So sensors are the most important part, which has caused a lot of tragedy in almost all engineering aspects, wherever errors or hazards has occurred, the sensors had failed. Okay. So the most important part is this one, as to the data origin itself. So please be very much thorough or sure about what you're using or what you're using to produce the data that you're feeding to your computer. Okay. So whenever you think of a project or a problem statement, think of the exact sensor part, which is most important to produce and give you the data. I'll introduce you to a lot of sensors today. Okay. Yeah. So then. Now, next part is what exactly ma'am told, is the communication part that has to be taken care. For a smart water distribution system, what can be the one of the best communication methods that can be used?
Wi-Fi,
of course. Wi-Fi is a very good thing to be used. Wi-Fi, do you have any other communication systems, that methods that you learned from the previous sessions? Yes. Okay, so for deciding communication systems, okay, for designing what communications you should use depends on the range in which your data has to move. Okay, so the simplest, I'm telling all of you, whenever you want, you cannot just for any application, you cannot use Bluetooth. For any application, you cannot use Wi-Fi. For any applications, you need not use LoRa. For example, if you are doing a health monitoring system, the distance the data has to travel to reach the main node is most important. Okay. Based upon that, you should decide on the communication system that you're going to use. Okay. So is Bluetooth a better option in water distribution system, or Wi-Fi or LoRa is better?
The decision need to be taken locally. Decision need to be taken locally quickly, so that it needs to be done with the LoRa.
Okay, why do you go for LoRa and not Wi-Fi?
So because power consumption is less in LoRa as compared to Wi-Fi, I feel.
What you said is
in LoRa, we can go up to 10 kilometers.
Up to 10 kilometers, okay. That thing is 10 kilometers range is there with LoRa.
That is what. Yes, sir.
Okay, so now you have two good options. Now Wi-Fi is a good option and LoRa is a good option. So depending upon where your control center is, and if power is an important concern for you, okay, and especially if
power and distance both, sir.
Yeah, power and distance. See, for example, if a water for a smart city, if it was within the city, okay, you need not, if for example the smart city is within a very smaller area, you need not go for a LoRa based system itself, where you can have a high, where the whole city is Wi-Fi connected and you have connectivity everywhere, then you can go for Wi-Fi. If you feel that the city does not have a good Wi-Fi infrastructure, then you can go for LoRa. For example, LoRa is very much helpful for power distribution systems, where the power distribution main offices and distribution happens in a very, very far off from the cities. Okay. There you can always go for an option for LoRa. Okay. So depending upon your application. Okay, depending upon application, we can choose a connectivity matters. Say for example, you are using, and especially power. So if you have power supply connection everywhere and you don't feel that, and Wi-Fi is also low power nowadays. So they are talking about next generation Wi-Fi. Okay, next generation Wi-Fi, the IEEE 802.11 protocol itself, they're going to modify for IoT, where thousands of nodes can be connected together. Okay, now they are coming up with protocols of that levels nowadays. Okay, so Bluetooth is not a good option is what I feel for water distribution systems. Maybe for a smaller area connected to be connected together, we can use a Bluetooth. If you have 4-5 sensors and you need to collect data from that, you can use Bluetooth. Then once your data is done, then you take any analytics program to work on it. Okay, so I will suggest people to work on smart water distribution systems. Okay, and now can anyone tell me what are the ways now control actions to be, what all things should be monitored now? When we saw about pressure, flow, TDS, pH and TDS, now what can the control action be? Now is the main part. So it's not about data being transmitted and reaching one place and we see it. Now you need to give back some signal back to it.
Yeah, reading the sensor value and validating within the range, then actuators are activated.
Yeah, so what ma'am said is correct. One is called the actuators. So actuators are nothing but devices, okay, which works on electrical signal. When you give an electrical signal supply to it, it converts to a physical supply, okay. And now in water distribution system, what can be the actuators? See, I'm not in this, there is nothing in the slide. I'm just making you people think and tell an answer to that because it is there in your day-to-day life. It's in your house. What the questions that I'm asking you is in your house itself.
Walls. Sir, we try to check for the TDS, sir.
Yeah.
If it is not maintained, then we try to add the supplements to make the pH value to our requirement. Like,
yeah, so you know that water, neutral water is having a neutral pH value, basically it's 7 only. So we will always see that our water is having a neutral pH always. Okay, and then is what he has said is about the TDS values. If TDS is varying, then we need to look into the RO plant itself. So a water distribution system will have a RO plant. The water from the RO will be checked for TDS, and we make sure that all the water that is coming out for, which is to be supplied to people, is having proper TDS and proper pH values is being checked always. If it is not so, say for example, you found that the TDS value is so high and the water supply is going towards all people. Now what will you do? You will give a actuation signal to the main valve so that the valve closes.
Now we will put the valves actually.
Exactly. So valve, we can send a signal to the valve to close it. So valves is one of the actuator that is inside a, that is required inside a water distribution system. Then for example, the tank is over, tank is overflowing. Now where should be the actuator signal go? Say I'm filling
the water level.
Motor.
Yeah. Okay. Motor or
horsepower motor. Yeah.
Yeah. Motor or generally.
From where the water is getting inputted, there the signal should go. It should be off.
Yeah. Okay. Wonderful. So the valve also can be closed as well as we can close the pump which is pumping water to the tank. Okay. So now we saw a few actuators. One is the valves and pumps. So valves and pumps are the most important part of a water distribution system. Now people can come up with a solution, correct? Now you know what are the inputs parameters that I require. I have a knowledge on the communication part and I have the knowledge on the actuators which are needed in order to control it. So with this system, it's up now. Tell me one more thing. Where all should the water flow should be monitored in a distribution system?
Sir, in rainwater, we need to see that whenever the field is filled up with more water, so the water should be drained outside. Like.
Okay, so that is the, for the drainage management.
In agriculture part. Like.
Okay, okay. So that is an agriculture
part. I feel there should be a dashboard where exactly we should see the input and output of water supply.
Okay, yeah, that's that now that will come into the visualization part. That's in the cloud itself. You can make web-based interfaces to connect all the sensor values. So you know all the sensor values. Now when it comes to a database, now you know where and what the value is. From that, you can, of course, I think so, people who are very good in computer science can come up with a web-based interface to show what each the value in the table is, correct? What value in each row is. So that should not be a problem for you people at all. Now, what I was talking about is this thing. In your house, now think of your own house where you're staying. Is the water metered?
Yes.
Yes, in everyone's house. Nowadays, yes. Public or a private companies come up with supply of water, and in every house, water is being monitored.
Yes, Kaveri Water Supply is now distributing the water meter to measure the water, and according to that, they are going charging. To project the bill to the company.
Exactly. So, yeah. Just like how we have our electricity billing system was made, our own water distribution system was also now getting monitored. So, all these things are becoming smart meters. Now, what we can understand is, from every house, we know the rate of water that has been consumed, and we know the inlet now. So if we match out what is the input as well as the output, now we can tell whether there is any loss of water in the distribution, okay, that has been happening. Okay, so water loss can be monitored, and we can know whether what people are consuming it properly, those can be monitored. Now, in a larger scale, I will tell you one more thing which you people can do is study how people are using water. Okay, so my research work was on electricity distribution system, where I monitored how people are using electricity. Now, one of the major research area which abroad countries are focusing on, or other researchers are focusing on, is the characteristics of how people consume electricity in cities. Okay, based upon that, we can always have a knowledge on how much storage of water is required for the city, and whether water will be available for the near future. All those things can be studied. Okay, it is Bangalore has taken up a very big project along with IISc to study the water monitoring and how as to how people are using electricity, because Bangalore is going to have very less water in the near future. So there, most of the major cities are going to face such problems in the near future, where our engineers has to do a lot of work. Okay, so now, yeah. Now next is a street lighting system. Okay, so lighting is a very important part. So exactly, so people, you have any doubts with the water monitoring system? Water management, anything you need to add, you can talk about, or anything you want to ask, whether you want to take up this project, if you have any doubts also, you can ask. Fine, I'll go forward. Okay, next we will go with what is called as a smart street lighting system. Now the question comes to you people. For a smart lighting system, what all are the things that has to be sensed?
You have to avoid the uses of lights during daytime.
Okay, avoid light using daytime. So that is the problems that are being faced generally. Avoid light using daytime. Then,
sir, instead of continuously switching on the street light, whenever there is some people or someone is trying to move on the footpath, so move if that street light glow, that would be better light.
Okay, so based upon the people's movement and the availability, the street light has to turn on brighter or like that, correct?
Sir, whenever required, it should be get available, and whenever not, it automatically should get off.
Okay, so it should turn on and off. Okay, turn on and off. Then,
conserve the energy. Conservation of energy.
Yeah, conservation of energy is a part. Now I'm asking you, what are the smart sensor now sense again? So one was the avoid, it should avoid daytime lighting. People's movement has to be monitored. It should be turned and on and off immediately. Then,
sir, we should avoid the cabling part, like we use the solar system with a battery charging.
Okay, solar system with the battery charging has to be there. So that means the sustainability
remote
has to
location
be brought in.
Can be used.
Okay, that's what sustainability has to be there. Remote locations. You cannot bring wiring to a long distance. Remote locations, you need to have lighting by itself. But even that lighting also should not glow in the daytime, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Now, okay, let's see that. We'll take up the two things which was most probably told. Avoid light during daytime and find people coming in the footpath. Now, what are the sensors required for avoiding the light during daytime? How to do that? Do we have a sensor for that?
Yes, sir. Daylight means as sunlight starts, there is some diodes which actually capture the light and they can say that.
Okay. So one is photodiode.
We can do it.
Yeah. So one is photodiode. I will also type over here. So I think that.
Yes, photodiode.
Photodiode. Okay. Or photodiode. Or phototransistor. Then. Photodiode, phototransistor is one of the sensors. Then what do you have?
Then for movement, sir, the sensors, movement sensors, if something is move, or temperature sensor, if with warmth also we can sense that something is there to on the light.
LDR.
For movement, we can use PIR sensor.
PIR sensor. Okay. So for movement, for motion sensor.
Yes,
so
sir.
So PIR is passive IR sensor, infrared sensor. Okay, good. So one is for LDR or photodiode or phototransistor. So which keeps or senses the light source. Okay, amount of light that is being incident on that, based upon that, whether you need lighting or not has to be measured. Other one is for the movement of vehicles or any people that is moving in the vicinity, you can use PIR sensor. So if you have this sensor, you can sense these two parameters very effectively. So now you people have come up with the sensing part itself. Now look into this particular diagram itself. What all are integrated in a smart lighting system is weather gauge. It can sense the rain is falling or the pressure that is being there is being sensed. Next is the ambient light sensor. Ambient light sensor is nothing but your LDRs can be used, or a photodiode or a phototransistor can be used. Okay. Then that is the sensor. Then you have a security camera, you have vehicle or a pedestrian traffic counter. So that's for a traffic counter. Then again, you have the PIR sensor for motion detection. Now they talk about the connectivity, the public Wi-Fi repeater modules. So nowadays, even in the future, what will happen is we will have all the street lights connected with Wi-Fi modules. Okay. Now then you have sustainable dimmable LED bulbs. Okay, so that's the you can control your LEDs lighting. So the sensor part was clear. Okay, we have now LDR or PIR sensor. So look into this picture, okay? Okay, look into this picture. You will have what is called as a anemometer for measuring the wind speed. You can measure the rain gauge for measuring the amount of rainwater that is falling. Then the wind direction is possible. Light sensor for finding out the ambient light. You can count the number of vehicles that is crossing a particular location. You can see people movement in this regions. So all these things can come up into a smart lighting system. So just think, in a smart city, there are n number of projects and each project requires a lot of work to be done on and a lot of research has to be done in order to do that. So people can take forward these things also for any national level competitions, and these things also you can take. So next is the PIR sensor, which we are talking about, which senses the heat source depending upon the movement of the people. So if a person moves, then the sensor is able to find out that there is a movement, and with this sensor's output, now you can turn on or turn off the light. Now, can you people tell me what is the actuator to be used in order to turn on or turn off a light? So imagine that we have a microcontroller, we have a Wi-Fi module which receives the signal, and the signal from the control center comes, you turn off the light in these places. Now, what can be the actuator to be used?
We can use relay switches.
Relay switches. Okay. So the sensors were those, actuators were relay switches. Okay. So now this is the closed loop. Now, whenever you start something, you can close the loop with this thing. You have the sensor as the input, actuator is the output thing. Okay. In between, you have your analytics happening. So this is where your whole system of IoT comes into picture. So initially it was about embedded systems, but just imagine the whole city with thousands of street lights. Instead of connecting all these things to an individual embedded system and working standalone, you connect to a centralized system where all monitoring can take place. A single smart light, a smart light will be so smart that it can measure n number of parameters at the same time, and from the whole city's picture can be brought into a single control system itself. Okay, for example, the corporation can view a lot of things by one application. So that is most important. And to control light, it is an is the easiest thing to control electricity. That is your relay switches. Okay, it's very cheap to work on. Okay, so next thing that we'll be looking into is called as smart parking systems. Now, to park, to see whether there is a parking is there or not, what kind of sensors can be used there?
PIR sensor for on the roof for detecting availability or not the vehicle.
PIR on roof. Okay. Okay, ma'am. So now we'll talk about the road parking slots. See, for example, you can look into this picture. In the picture, we have the roads, cars has to be parked. Now, how to know that?
Sensor on the ground, sir. Then
sensors on the ground. So what kind of sensors can be done?
PIR or touch sensor.
Okay, PIR, touch sensor, then using LoRa. Yeah, LoRa is a communication device, Kartikeyan sir. Now we are talking about the sensor that that needs to be placed in order to see whether the car is being parked there or not. So this picture is giving a clear idea of how it should be.
From the pixel itself, it's a geometric detection by the help of geometric
detection. Yeah,
that's the right. Electronics are then nowadays tags are coming in the car or in dashboard.
Yeah, exactly. So now you know that nowadays people are using fast tags in your toll gates.
Yes.
So that is a kind of RFID detection. So like that. So it's a magnetic pickup switches can be used to detect whether the particular object is being coming above that or not. Okay, you can use ultrasound, can be used like that. Many applications are there, but there should be some reliable sensor which is always available, that when the car is being there, it should detect that there's a car is there. Okay, and when the car is not there, it should give the signal. So those things has to be received in a centralized controller system, and this has to be received by every car that is available in that particular area. So an app which can show where the parking slots are available can be produced by the government itself to showcase that there is a parking slot available at this particular point. Okay, so in the previous slide I was showing one particular company. Okay, the company's name is Libelium. Okay, the company's name is Libelium. So Libelium comes up with a lot of, you can go into the website, okay, Libelium, where you can find sensors for almost all the applications that is required. Okay, and you can buy the hardware if you have funding projects, and if you have funding money available with you people, so kindly go for Libelium based projects. So they are very good. You can acquire industrial grade sensors. I'm talking about industrial grade. Why? Because whenever you want to make up, you have get a funding proposal and you want to make products, do not make up those projects with Arduino or Raspberry Pi. which are not industrial grades. Though you can show up proof of concepts with those things, you can go up with a branded company projects also. Though they are not open sources, but still you have good quality products coming out. Okay, and a lot of sensors that are available. So sensors need not be open source always, right? So only the coding part you can think of open source and giving for free. And whereas the hardware part should be reliable and it should always withstand those things. Nowadays, even those companies come up with hardwares for edge computing, which is open sources. Okay, so kindly make note of these Libelium sensors. They are very good and industrial graded, okay, to be used. Okay, so smart parking systems. So we need the geomagnetism sensors or electronic tag systems, which can always sense the presence of this. Even in a simpler manner, IR sensors also can be used for proof of concepts. But I generally don't prefer using IR sensors for simple parking systems you can use, but not for a smart city based system. So depending upon your application, if you're making a smart parking system in a small location only, well, 10 cars can be parked. For such things, tags can be used. Okay, so based upon your applications, change your sensors also, which gives more reliability and better outputs. Okay, and look at the connectivity. Now they have used a communication base station. From there it receives. So we will talk about this thing, how edge computing will be helpful for such things. Instead of sending data directly to the cloud, how an edge computing comes into picture, which is going to help the whole smart system or the IoT based system, which is going to be more reliable when you use edge computing. So when cloud computing was introduced, IoT was not much booming, and they were not considering IoT based systems. Pushing so much amount of data into the cloud was not thought about. So that's why the concept of edge computing started to come. We'll discuss that. Okay. So this is GPRS or Wi-Fi or any communication module can be used to send to the management system in order to make a smart parking system in cities. Okay, I don't know how effectively we will be able to do in cities like in countries like India, where our everyone has a car and we don't have parking spaces as defined in these places. Okay, let's hope that we'll have one city which is so much well planned and well modeled. In the near future, even India will have such smart cities in place. Okay, so this is one thing which I wanted to talk to you people regarding temperature measurement. Look at the different temperature measurement systems. Generally, I've seen people use LM35 always whenever it comes to temperature measurement, okay, and showcase demonstrations. But there are different sensors also, depending upon the range of temperatures where we should list out different sensors. We should find out what kind of range is being needed for our thing, and then we use. So for a normal general outside temperature, IC sensors are more than enough. But there are other sensors like RTD, okay, resistance temperature detector. So this is based on a resistance temperature detector, something called a thermistor. So look at the temperature range from minus 250 degrees Celsius to plus 750 degrees Celsius. Thermistors can measure from minus 100 to plus 500. Thermocouple from minus 267 to 2316 degrees Celsius. So when you want to measure extremely high temperature, you go for a sensor called thermocouple. Okay. Then you have IC sensors also for detecting. So your mobile phones has IC sensors for detecting the temperatures of your mobile phone. That's why you get your mobile phone's temperature is higher than that of the outside, or you get those notifications only because you have a temperature sensor within your mobile phone. Okay, so just have this thing in mind regarding the temperature sensors. So before going into an application, you want to do some project, list out these things. What are the available things? What is our problem statement's range of problem that it has to detect? And then how these things can be applied or what has to be chosen is an important part. Okay, so any doubts so far?
No, sir.
Sir, as you mentioned that you would be talking about Arduino and Python, which one is good for IoT development? You said that you will be addressing about it.
Yes, ma'am. What did you do? Arduino or?
Python and Arduino, some hint you had given, which language is good at going with IoT products and our projects. Then which kind of hardware kit is suitable? Raspberry Pi, Arduino, these comparisons you mentioned that you will be doing. Then another thing is which language would be preferable for this kind of applications.
Okay, so I'll talk about this when I talk in the edge computing platform itself. Those things I'll cover now. Okay, so
thank you, sir.
When to use Arduino, when to use Raspberry Pi. And so that is one of the very, very important thing that people has to understand. And whether should you really need a Raspberry Pi in every situation? Should you really need only Arduino is enough? Or is the Arduino the only board that is available to make things done like that? Okay, we'll talk about that now. Edge computing. Okay, so edge or fog computing. Initially what happened in the year 2014, Cisco came up with this concept called fog computing. So just like cloud computing, a term called fog computing, which talked about bringing cloud nearer to the edges. It is not a replacement for the cloud, but whereas it is an added advantage for the cloud. Now you know that clouds are centralized data centers, which is available only in a very few places that is there, and you make data available to everyone at every point of time. But applications of like industries and domains where you need immediate control actions, like medical care and healthcare, where you need required immediate attentions, and the data has to be, what to say, and the data is redundant. There was a lot of bandwidth issues that was happening in the cloud. Say for example, for every 10 minutes, the same data has been received in the cloud. There's so much of wastage of storage as well as wastage in the bandwidth used. One more thing is that for the criticality of the data, when the data has to travel all the way to the cloud and then a control action has to be sent back to the control action has to be taken, the time of that latency is more than sufficient for a damage to be occurred in the problem domain. So in that case, Cisco came up with a concept of fog computing where there is a memory space in the place, there is a processing capability, as well as there is a connectivity part also in this a particular router which act as a gateway itself, okay, where it can work on all the five layers of your OSI layer. So generally, you know, routers works only in the first three layers, physical data link and your network layer. Whereas now they brought in a concept called edge routers, where it can look into the data itself, do the analysis, and then send back only needed information to the cloud. So the major concept is, so Internet of Things connected to the edge local processing, okay? Internet of Things connected to the local processing, and then local edge processing, and this is called as the edge gateway. From there, the data either goes to the cloud, or the data can go to a storage center for storage alone. It can go to the cloud for the people to see or the visualize how the data is and what control action has to be taken care of. That also can be done. Or else when there are critical data that is coming in, an immediate control action has to be taken place, the edge local processing itself will give control actions. So in such way, edge computing is going to aid the cloud computing model itself. So next, what we'll be looking into is how the fog computing function and the cloud computing works integratedly. Okay. So on the left-hand side, if you see, we have the large amount of data that is coming in from every different kinds of applications. So large volume of data, the wide variety of things from which the data is being transmitted, and the high velocity of the data that is being generated. So we talked about the different V's, and there are other V's also coming up, value and things like that. But in taking the primary three V's, the volume, velocity and the variety of data that comes in, the fog node now collects this data. Okay. And now what it does, It does data reduction, it gives controlled response, and it gives data virtualization and standardization. Okay, and then sends back these things to the cloud. Only what you do is, after data reduction, only the necessary information is being passed onto the cloud. So the virtualized data, the historical but predictive analytics, and the machine learning happens in the cloud. You cannot do a lot of processing over here. For example, from millions of nodes, when the data is coming up, you send important data to the cloud, and analysis and all those things can be done in the cloud. Now, what can be pushed back to your fog nodes are your rules and patterns.
Sir, you please disable them, sir. Go to more. This is happening every day. That annotation every day in front of chief guest also they are doing.
Okay.
All our faculty.
Okay, no problem. Anyways, so kindly note this particular image. It's very much useful. Okay. So this is the whole concept of the fog computing itself. You have the cloud in one end. You have the end nodes which produce the data in one end. And you have the computing section at the center part in between. Now, cloud is a centralized infrastructure, whereas your fog is a distributed infrastructure. Okay. So the distributed infrastructure, what happens is that for every 10 nodes, you can have a fog node available. Okay. And look at this. You can update your rules and patterns to your fog node immediately. Once that has been done, you know that when the machine is being learned and you have the machine learning model being pushed to your Raspberry Pi or a computer, within every second, the patterns can be identified. So updating here, okay. And what is the advantage of this thing is, since the rules are being updated in a regular fashion, much more better insights can be obtained from the fog node itself. Okay, the greatest advantage of the fog computing part itself is that it is going to reduce the latency between the nodes to your cloud. It is going to have a distributed control architecture. And one more thing is that the regular updation of the patterns and these things can take place in the fog node itself. Okay, so now with this idea of fog computing, I'll show you a few hardwares which can help in a fog computing. As on the left hand side, you see something called as a BeagleBone plaque. You can use chat. How safe it is used to you? How safe is it using fog node? If fog node is hacked, isn't that our data in the cloud is data that our cloud is stolen? The greatest advantage they brought in while using fog nodes is that it is distributed, and that locally we can identify if a fog node is being hacked itself from the cloud center itself. Okay, so directly the security concerns, the security levels also is distributed. Now you can locate a particular fog node which is being malfunctioning and things like that. Okay, so and if at all a particular fog node is damaged, only that particular fog node is, or the data from that is compromised, whereas the whole system does not get compromised. That is the one more advantage. Hardware level security is also available in this fog node so that it is not tampered up. So the security also is being distributed. So such kind of advantages is there when you talk about fog computing. So the on the left hand side, what you see is called as a BeagleBone plaque. BeagleBone, and the right side that you see is a Google GPU, TPU, sorry, a Google TPU itself. So you people have heard of TPUs? Yes. Google has come up with Edge. It's Google Edge. It's called Google Edge. So now all companies, now once this Cisco introduces fog routers, Google has introduced their edge computing platforms, and all companies now have a edge computing platforms because this is most widely used in industrial applications. So all industrial applications require edge computing. They cannot rely only on the cloud computing platform. Okay. And it is high power. Now machine learning can happen. Google is coming up with hardware processors where even machine learning can take place even in the edge level itself. Okay, it is distributed edge machine learning systems are coming up. Okay, tensor processing units are there. Now, as one of our madam was talking about smart homes. So this is an application, so which was a part of my PhD work also, is on the smart IoT based power distribution system, where fog computing or fog routers also plays an important role. So what we have done is we have connected all the different houses, okay, houses to a fog node. Now you'll be thinking, what can be fog nodes? So fog node is nothing but a node which has a routing capability, which has storage capability, which has processing capability. So any device which can do routing, storage and processing together. So it should have a router as well as a this capability. If you have any device that can be acting as an edge device. So your Raspberry Pi also can act as an edge device here. You can use your BeagleBone Black. If you're going for standard items, there is called as Libelium Mesh Router. So it's called Meshlium. Libelium also has an edge router device. You can also use a Cisco edge routers. You can search for that. So if you are if you have project fundings, the edge routers by those industries will cost around like 1.5 lakhs. Okay. So clouds are in crores. Fog nodes cost in lakhs. Edge devices cost in hundreds and thousands of rupees is the end nodes, the end devices. So you can talk about even Raspberry Pi costs around 4,000 rupees nowadays. Raspberry Pi 4, which is the latest part, which has Bluetooth, which has Wi-Fi, which has all connectivity, comes up with 4,000 rupees. So minimum for fog devices will cost around like 1,000 rupees for prototypes. Whereas when you go for the real implementation, industrial grade implementations takes thousands of rupees, okay, or lakhs of rupees for your fog nodes. The fog node has two types of connectivity. One is the lower end level connectivity, which can be your 6LoWPAN, ZigBee, or RF communications. Even Wi-Fi is also possible, okay, in your lower end. On the other end, which is called as a backhaul network, if you look into this diagram, this backhaul network, this can be 3G network, or it can be the LAN connectivity, which can connect or send data to the cloud or the center where the observation has to take place. Okay. Now for this work, I used the protocol called RPL. So RPL, if people have shared about RPL protocol in the last classes, then it is routing protocol for low power lossy area networks, which can be used, which is a very good effective protocol. Or people can use MQTT, which is being taught. From homes, your data has to travel to the fog node and from there to the data center. Now, the greatest advantage is this fog nodes can be programmed using Python programming language. Nowadays, every companies are providing the advantage of easy programming. Okay, as a programming language, you need to know Python. Knowing Python alone is more than sufficient to work on n different applications as proof of concepts. Whereas when you go for an application point of view, it depends on the customer. Okay, so but for secure from homes, data has to be collected. Regular metering can take place. Now, what work has been done so far is like you study the usage pattern of people in a regular manner. Okay, and nowadays, what you can do is at the end of the day, you can send information back to the people stating that. See, your consumption of electricity is like this. For the next few days, your pattern of electricity consumption is going to be this. And the billing will happen in such and such manner. So if you are able to constrain or reduce the usage, you will have better bill at the end of the month. So such kind of real-time insights can be provided to individual customers or individual consumers. Since the edge computing is being locally processing, maybe around 10 homes will be connected to a fog router. So from there, every individuals can be controlled or taken care, okay, in a power distribution system. So as of now, BESCOM or other electricity companies do not know what your individual usage pattern is. They come monthly, they come, note down the reading, and you have to pay the bill. Okay, so from your usage pattern in the previous years also, computers can now define and find out an insight that, okay, your consumption of electricity is like this and such manner, because electricity is very important nowadays because of the more usage of fossil fuels and the carbon emission is more. So now people are moving into renewable energy integration. So the availability of solar, wind is also an important part that has to be taken care. Now, next question is to you people. What are the sensors that is required for a power distribution system to monitor a house power usage? What are the sensors that is required?
Energy meter.
Okay, energy meter. Okay, smart energy meter is required. So in energy meter, what are the energy meter? What are the two parameters that is required?
Number of units consumed.
Yeah, so units consumed is based upon what?
Wattage.
So what in the sense wattage. Wattage is the result of two parameters, right? What are the two parameters? Yes. Yeah, current and voltage and current. Okay, Karthikeyan sir, what you said is correct. It is current and voltage. Okay, so two parameters, the voltage I into R. So we know that we know the relationship V is equal to IR. Okay, and the resistance is for every devices and the voltage and current. So what is the supply voltage generally that comes to the Indian power supply? We supply electricity in terms of 230 volt. Correct. So we supply 230 volt supply is what we get in our houses. It varies from 210 up from 200 to 240 like that. It varies, but not less. The lesser the voltage, the more current it consumes. Okay. Since based upon the R value, which is constant in all your devices. So lesser voltage, more heat will be generated in the devices. So it's not good to have low voltage supply in your houses. And more current is being consumed from different devices, there are chances that some internal circuitry problem is there, and a lot of things can be analyzed by measuring these two values, which is your voltage and current. So in order to stop cut anything, you just need to have a relay in order to cut the supply to that particular device. So the actuator is your relays. You can have n number of relays to control, turn automatically turn on and off tube lights or fans or any supply. Relay is more than sufficient. But you need to measure the voltage and current. Okay, so here are the four pictures which I have given. So there is something called as DC and AC. One is alternating current and one is the DC supply, which is direct current. So can anyone tell me what is the supply that is coming to our houses? Is it
230 AC volt.
230 AC. Volt. AC or DC?
AC.
AC. Okay, it's 230 volt AC. Correct. So, but just imagine that you have a laptop. What is the supply that comes out of your that goes into your laptop?
DC.
What goes inside your mobile phone?
DC. Again, DC.
Everything. So, if you look into most of the devices that we use, though the supply that comes in is AC, what goes what is taken in is DC only. Okay, so that is something which is actually happening. Now we have sensors for that. Okay, for measuring voltage, that is the DC voltage as well as the AC voltage. So if you look into over here, you have a box which is a transformer. So this is on the right side voltage sensor. Okay, which is going to measure AC. You need a transformer to step down the voltage levels and to be measured by the small IC. And what you see on over here is a voltage sensor, which is 25 volt DC supply, which can be measured. So you have sensors for AC and DC. So generally what we call them, okay, generally what we call them is a current transformer or a potential transformer or a voltage transformer. CT stands for current transformer, PT transformer, potential transformer or a voltage transformers. This is the most important part to measure the data. Once you get this particular data correctly, you can send the data to the Arduino, Bluetooth, connectivity, and anywhere. Okay, so it's taking the range. Say for example, you want to measure the voltage that is coming to your laptop. You need to connect a DC supply voltage which is less than 25 volt after your adapter point only. From your adapter, it's getting converted to your DC. Okay, if you want to measure the DC voltage, If you want to measure the AC voltage, you go to a 230 volt range AC voltage measuring ICs. So what you see over on the left hand sides are current transformers. One is the clamp type. So current transformer need not be attached to the wires directly. You know that current is going in a serial manner, whereas voltage is across two points. Current is always through the line. So you just have to clamp the clamp it above the wire in order to measure the current that is flowing in. Okay. So the clamp type that is on this part is your current transformer clamp type, which can measure up to 50 milliamps. Okay. So 50 milliamps is the output. So for 100 amps, up to 100 amps it can measure. So it's a high current measuring current transformer. So it is having a magnetic coil which will step down the current levels to 50 milliamps itself. So this is called as current transformers, which has secondary coils which reduces the current levels, and we can be sensed by these ICs, and the output can be obtained in a digital manner. What you see over here is a digital current transformer. This is an analog signal which comes out through a 3.5 mm jack. And you know that your Arduino has, I mean your Raspberry Pi has a 3.5 mm jack. You can connect the signal directly and get it and read the serial port. Okay, from here CT also, through this hole you just have to put the wire and then connect the circuitry so that you can measure the current through the circuit. Okay, so with this sensors you can develop your own power monitoring system inside your house itself for a home automation system. You can do it separately and you can measure, you can give control actions and things accordingly. Okay, two very important parts. Okay, next is smart waste management system. So current power energy is a very important part which people can take up forward. There are other parameters also that can measure, which is more into electrical. It is like the phasor measurement unit. So I don't know whether there are triply people attending this thing. So for triply people, it's a smart grid applications. And this is a very important part where computer science people can club together to work a lot on the data analytics, time series analysis, harmonic detections, and things like that. A lot is a separate big domain to work on itself, the energy management system. Okay, so on those doubts you can ask. Then is the smart waste management system. Tell me, what are the sensors required for waste management? So the rest all part, all of you know, you have connectivity. You can have 3G or 4G, then the cloud server, and you can give the information to the driver cellular connected so that the driver comes and collects it. Now, but how do you sense this? For a smart bin, what all you should give to the bin so that
touch sensor, sir.
Level sensor.
Level yes, sensor. Touch sensor.
Okay, level sensor is a very very good important aspect. This is a solid base, so you should remember level sensor cannot be used as the same sensor that we use for a water level sensor cannot be used for a solid base systems.
Okay, ultrasonic sensor, sir. Ultrasonic.
Yeah, ultrasonic sensors can be used.
There are different kind like wet and dry.
Yes.
So in the wet weight, it should not be any kind of electronic or any kind of metal sensors. Metal.
Exactly.
So segregation sensors, I mean, I don't know with what kind of sensors are going to be used, but no. It is necessary to.
Yes. So segregation plants all can be done separately as a bigger plant where you see in the left side corner. There's so much of waste being done. There only we can do segregation because
like in wet bin, it should not be electronic item or any dry item or any kind of should not be kept. So automatically it starts blinking that it's not the bin.
Okay. So what is going into the bin has to be sensed. Yeah, that's also fine. That can be done. Then, so level sensors like ultrasound is a very important sensor that can be used. Then can we work on something called as the
temperature sensor also, as the the dustbin is going to be like a 2-3 days old waste, so germs and other will just start generating, and the temperature is going to be increased, so we'll get to know that how old it is, like from there.
Okay.
We can
okay Yeah, so even we can even know that in how many days things are being dispatched. We can study the rate on which that garbage is getting filled. So this is one of the important aspects which is coming up, which has been sent as a proposal to the DST for Texas Instruments competitions, which we are working on, is on smart waste management. So the proposal is like this, like we can study the rate in which in a particular in area where the dustbins are getting filled, and we can en route the people in such a way that always the garbage is collected in such a pattern, so that the always the city, the garbages are being collected in a regular and a correct manner, so that some areas will have overflowing of dustbins very fast, some areas will fill in a slower manner. So even if you are able to study the characteristics and the rate in which it's filling, all those things can be helpful. So same like water management system, we can also have a lot of insights can be put, a lot of engineering mind if you put into it, you can see different means. Only thing is that the type of sensor that is required, even people can work on load cells. So the base of the dustbins can always have load cell in order to always study the weight in which weight that is being carried or how much it is getting filled. All those things can be studied. We can not with one sensor, for 2-3 sensors, a correlation we can study and to find out whether it is, so computers can learn by itself. So Kevin Aston's dream that computer should be able to see, smell and sense things, okay, without human intervention. So but the knowledge can be given only by humans.
Sir, one more thing, like if the sensors get to know that whether which is much more faster should be emptied, like all the wet ones should not be delayed from 2 days or such kind of, so decision making must be much, is going to be much more better.
Exactly. Because
all the waste are not immediate, dumping is not important, like dry waste or electronic waste, we can dump afterwards also, but some immediate dumping should be
there. Exactly. So the city is always clean, and so the germs don't spread very easy, very fast, like that. I think should be clean. So such kind of intimations can be provided to the garbage collecting unit, so that they come on correct
time. Immediately they do the work.
Immediately they do the work, and to they should know, they should see in a web interface as to the exact location.
So GPS tracking,
exactly. So based upon the location, see in this picture itself, it is going to the nearest tower. Okay, location of the smart bin. See over here, they are showing, correct, the location of the smart bin. So the location of the smart bin can be detected as to where it is. And those areas can be spotted out to the collecting municipalities or those bins where these locations are the important. And even you can go into a little more inside as to you can en route, the route in which these garbage people has to travel, so as the correctly these things are being delivered or taken care and brought back to the management systems. So there are some students have come up with a lot of innovative ideas where placing the waste in the correct bins can be provided incentives. And even there will be other group of people who will collect this waste and go to the segregation unit to segregate it. So all those things can be integrated into a single unit for into a smart city to bring them to a reality. So smart waste management, so solid waste, their ultrasound sensors are very good actually to work with solid waste management. Okay, so this is the simplest libelliums. Okay, there's a mistake. So this is from libelliums. Okay, yeah. So this is.
Sir, even this question I have one of the participant asked, lifetime of the sensors need to be considered, and what time period we need to replace, how to detect about sensor failure, these kind of questions. Even I have that doubt, sir.
Okay, ma'am. One second. And people have asked about the lifetime of these sensors. I mean, should we replace the sensor after some time? See, that's what I told you, right? The most important part of the any unit or any IoT based system is the sensor itself, as the correct data. So if you get wrong data, we are doing things wrong. Okay, that has happened even with the Challenger, the tragedy also that has happened. The sensors failed, but they couldn't detect the failure of sensors. So basically, I told you, right, using two or three types of sensors and finding the correlation between them is an important factor also. You do not depend on only one sensor to do a thing. You rely on two, three things so that you find the relationship between these sensors. Is it working correctly? Basically, to an instrumentation perspective, there are situations where you really require hard critical situation where you cannot have a failure of a sensor. So you will have six types of sensors or a minimum three. So if two out of a sensor gets failed, you will have to change the sensor for sure. Like that. So based upon the criticality of the application that you're using, you should use n number of sensors correctly. Okay. Sensors operate on battery. If not, I am wrong. Not necessarily all sensors work on battery. There is something called as passive sensor, active transduction. Actually, the term sensor itself is wrong. It's called transduction. It's called the transducers. Okay. It's called transducers. Transducers are equipments which convert any physical parameter into electrical signals. So it's called as a process called transduction. There is something called as active sensors. There is something called as passive sensors. Active sensors do not require the efficient working is depending on climatic conditions. Exactly. So sensors are of different types. So active sensors, passive sensors. Passive sensors which gives out by themselves, they don't need any supply to work on. Say for example, your load cell. Okay, your load cell is a resistance change. When you apply weight on it, its resistance changes. And when you connect to a Wheatstone bridge, the change in resistance is provided as an output. So as such, this resistance, it's only the mechanical change on the device which is giving the output. Thermocouple is working on a different principle. The temperature changes between the edges, the voltage is being produced. So thermocouple does not generally require a voltage. The voltage is generated by itself. Okay. So LDR sensor, exactly. So light dependent sensor, as doctor is talking about, is a sensor which is light dependent resistance. So based upon the changes in light, depending on the light, the resistance changes. So it can be connected to a Wheatstone bridge again to a change in the voltage. I will of course share to this to madam the Word document, okay, which will have the document will I will share, okay, which I have all the links to these sensors. I will suggest you people can take all these sensors from Amazon itself. For if it's only for a proof of concept, don't even worry. You can work on any sensors as of now. But if you're really working with government projects and working with the good companies, consultancies, then you should use products which are of good quality. Trusted devices like US-based companies are there. For different sensors, there are different manufacturers who provide good quality electronics. Like in India, you have Keltron, which gives a lot of insights into your, which gives a lot of good electronic products. Do not buy it from Chinese. Take it from Indian electronic companies itself, which provides good quality electronics. Okay, which subject it is more important in Industry 4.0? For Industry 4.0 I have the slide for Industry 4.0 also. Industry 4.0, when you want to work on, you need to have computer science knowledge as well as electronics knowledge. Big data and all those things are also an important part. Okay. Data analytics is a very important part in Industry 4.0, whereas you need to have knowledge on what all are the sensors to be connected. So why I gave more importance to sensor connectivity was, what people generally do is connect any sensors and just get data. Those are not the correct values to do things. Few more questions I missed previously, I think so. Depending on the climatic conditions. Of course, depending on the climatic conditions, you will have to, there is something called a data sheet for any sensors. Or when our product comes, there's a data sheet. You see the data sheet and you see whether this particular equipment will suit our country. So do not think that all foreign country equipments are very good to work in Indian conditions. Not necessarily. So they will produce products based, see, for example, European countries sensors basically will be designed in such a way that it works in their climatic conditions. So that's why DRDO and Army Department all work with electronic components, which is self-made in India, so that these things work with standard conditions of Indian perspectives. For example, you know that Leh and Ladakh regions, the ISIS has to perform there in that climatic conditions. Okay, so sensors has to be designed and developed in to work under such test conditions also. A sensor failure is very much tragic in such kind of situations. So even we know that our landing into the moon had some problem with sensor connectivity. At the last moment, we couldn't land on the moon, which was because of a sensor which had a problem at that particular point of time. So we still do not know the exact reason why, but there was a sensor which was from the US, which was being integrated, though it was, everything was self-made. So we are not sure. So it's better to have indigenous sensor developed for conditions of Indian conditions. Okay, we should study the climatic conditions also. When we look into if it's a hazardous situations, your normal level sensor cannot work with a chemical plant, chemical that is being used. So based upon that, we should have corrosion resistant materials to be used. Such kind of things has to be taken care. Okay, which subject? Okay, so hope Ganesh, you're clear with the subject domain is machine learning, AI is an important part, okay, and a sensor technology part, which I will tell. You should know, now this is a holistic picture. I told you, IoT, you cannot say it's a one-departmental process. So especially for Industry 4.0, you have mechanical parts coming up, you have machineries, you have a lot of machines working over there. You need to know about motors. Okay, you need to know about the range in which motors are there, what is the vibration of the motors. If there is any fault that is occurring, going to occur in the particular machine, you need to know. If that, you need to know about that, you should, only the particular person knows this is a failure, this particular data is a failure, going to occur, has a failure, only a domain expert will know. So domain expertise is also an important part. See, if you look into this picture itself, there are a number of things, big data, automation, smart industry, renewable energy integration. So electrical, mechanical, civil, computer science, electronics, everything comes into a single culmination to work with Industry 4.0. In many colleges, I have seen mechanical people taking 4.0 as an important subject. But the greatest advantage of a computer science people is that they can enter into any domain. They can work with any people to work on this. Some of the things which I left out in the sessions are about smart infrastructure monitoring, especially the bridges and tall buildings. Monitoring such things is an important, very, very important part. Okay, you can work with civil engineering people in order to monitor bridges. If you people are interested to work on such domains, it will be an excellent project for Indian perspective, which you can take forward, apply for funding on infrastructure monitoring, especially the bridges. You know that nowadays there are a lot of bridges have been concerned with the British people only, and the lifetime is being reducing. You can put sensors to it and keep studying the vibrations, and you can have a predictive maintenance. Okay, you can tell if this particular condition is being prevailing, there is a chance that this can fall down or this bridge can collapse in the near future. So to that extent, we can work on such domains, and IoT with computer science, ML is going to, give breakthrough domains into this. So hope machine learning and all those things, most of you would have taken now. By now you would have learned machine learning algorithms, you would have learned regression algorithms, you would have learned classification algorithms and all those things. You will be thorough by nowadays, because a lot of workshop has been taken place. A lot of webinars have happened during this lockdown period. And you would have come up with a lot of knowledge on those aspects. Now, what I'll suggest is you can go through a lot of textbooks on sensors and things like that, so that how can you generate good data? So not the wrong data, the correct data for your application is very, very important. Okay, so that's it from my side regarding Industry 4.0 is an important part which is coming up, and the integration of industry is still not ready to connect internet towards the factory. Okay, so because of the security reasons, edge computing is an important part which the industry will look into. Okay, smart industry, you can look into different industrial. Now what is Industry 4.0? Industry 3.0 is what industry is focusing now, or what the industry is doing now, that is the automation, automatic manufacturing of units and things like that. What they have not brought into is your big data analytics, your predictive maintenance or preventive maintenance. Before a machine fails, will you be able to deliver insights to the company people stating that there is going to be a failure in the machine in the near future? Okay, which can be done by means of predictive analytics and machine learning algorithms. Okay, so that you should that all you can take care. And any doubts regarding these kinds of applications or domains, you can put forward to me always. And so at the end, what I can say is that smart city is a reality. It will come for sure, and we are capable of doing it. So once again, why I showed so many people is, as Indians, we are also capable of doing a lot of things. If we apply our brains, even we can come up with a lot of innovative solutions to different problems that is the world is facing. So I encourage all of you to do that. Can we know any other possibilities in failure of networking when working with IoT? Of course, it's the wireless connectivity itself. The wireless connectivity, you as you know, it's not the exact reliable connectivity, correct? In industries, they never use wireless connectivity. I was working in a thermal power plant, and I have seen hundreds and thousands of sensors connected to a single computer system. So where we take the control for, it's called the DCS or the distributed control system, where we do all the control actions from a single computer. All the sensors, hundreds and thousands of sensors, are connected by means of wires only to the single board. Okay, where we have input output ports. Okay, and from there we acquire data to the computer. A wire means you are connected end to end. Reliability is there. There is no tampering in between, no intrusion. But when it comes to wireless, failures of disturbances from outside, noises, a lot of data loss can happen, especially in power plants. Can you imagine the temperature, for example, it's coming 800 by the transmission loss. If you lose the data, it's very important. So wired connectivity is the most secure connectivity that can happen in industries. So when you talk about Industry 4.0, focus on wired connectivity itself to work on. So when you go to an industry and tell that I am connecting a wireless device, they will think twice before accepting your proposal itself. But you say that I am connecting all the sensors via wire to this particular thing, they will take up your proposal. At the end of the day, what you require is analytics only. So it is more than wireless. Maybe from remote locations where you cannot take wires out of a component, you can go for wireless. Dr. Sumita ma'am, is it, I think so, I have answered your question. Yes ma'am, what the question is exactly valid. Those things, even we are facing, right? When we are talking about the wireless, even the Wi-Fi is failing a lot of time. Especially during this lockdown period, you can see how our bandwidth is less. A lot of disturbances are happening. Can you rely on such networks? So that's why people are moving to 5G, where they define software-defined networking is coming up for connectivity part in wireless. So 5G will change the world of what we are looking into for industries also. Yes, so this is that's it from my side. You can take down my number and my mail ID. Any doubts you can put forward to me, always I'll be ready to answer to your questions. Okay, the same number is WhatsApp. You can WhatsApp me also. Okay. Can you suggest any funding related projects with IoT? Ma'am, I'll tell you the we have sent to DST competition itself. When we sent the projects that were accepted was power distribution system got accepted. Then another one was the Internet of Vehicle system got accepted. Then other thing is the waste management system. Waste management with IoT. Actually 9 projects were accepted, but what I see 3 major things which they were looking into is smart energy management. Whatever proposals you go, there is good chance of getting accepted. Energy management, waste management, power distribution, then traffic management. No, more than traffic management, the Internet of Vehicles, electric vehicle systems. If you are working, there is tremendous chances in IoT based systems. Water management, ma'am. Water management. Most of the headings that I have given today are very, very important applications which is required for our country in the near future, especially in Industry 4.0 agriculture. Terrace agriculture, if you are providing for the cities, such kind of things in developing cities where agriculture is a very big question mark. If you can bring up with an IoT based system for regular monitoring and still you are able to helps the people out for having good quality food. That's also an important thing. And I will give one more suggestion. It's called the Internet of Food. Internet of Food.
One more thing, hydroponics also, by maintaining the pH value, we can go with the hydroponics.
Yeah, hydroponic system. So we have, if you look into my, I have worked on hydroponics. Tamil Nadu Coimbatore Agricultural University is a university which was working on hydroponics for the past 10 years. There are good lot of research that has been done on hydroponics. And one of my students is in Canada. So even there, they are encouraging such things. Though hydroponics and aeroponics was invented by Israeli people, everywhere in the world, that is going to be the next future which can come up. Okay, so kindly note this thing called as Internet of Food. I hope most of them is hearing Internet of Food for the first time. So from where the food is being produced to where it goes, everything can be analyzed. And if any of you are working with blockchains, you can integrate blockchains with Internet of Food. Blockchains with Internet of Food is a very new domain to work with. And you can write proposals based upon this. That is from, you have nowadays apps, right? Farm to home. Farm to home concept. Blockchains with Internet of Food from farm to home. So you exactly know from where the food is being produced and where it has reached your refrigerator and how much energy you're consuming. If the food was faulty, you can trace back up till from where the food was being generated and from where it was being produced. So this is also an important research domain where people can work upon.
The last question, Raspberry Pi and Arduino, when to use?
Okay. That's what's important. Okay. Now tell me, can anyone tell me the difference between Arduino and a Raspberry Pi? I'm asking you yourself, other people around them. Can you tell me the difference between an Arduino
Raspberry Pi, we can use it as a gateway also.
Yeah, Raspberry Pi, we can use it as a gateway also. Okay, Arduino?
Arduino, we need additional devices to be connected to make it a function.
Okay, if we connect an Ethernet shield, it becomes a gateway, right?
Yes.
Now tell me again the difference between an Arduino and a Raspberry Pi.
In Arduino, it follows C language, just C++. But when it comes to Python, it has got a Linux environment where more security can be included.
No, you can write Arduino code in Python also. You can now Python scripting is more than enough in for Arduino also.
Okay. I'm not aware of it.
Yeah.
Raspberry is a full-fledged computer.
Yeah.
And Arduino is it's not full-fledged computer exactly.
It's a microcontroller. So
just a microcontroller.
No, it's. Arduino is not a microprocessor.
Can be used as a
Arduino. So Arduino was never
an
Arduino. Arduino is only a company.
And okay. Raspberry Pi has an operating system. Huh. Oh, sorry. Raspberry Pi has an operating system. Oh, not micro, sorry. I've used wrong word. Arduino won't have any operating system. Whatever thing. But.
Okay, let me tell you one thing. Yeah, Arduino is actually a company. Okay.
Hello.
Hello, can you hear?
Hello.
Hello.
Nidhi, we could hear you. Otherwise, you chat mode.
Yeah. So I'll tell you one more thing. Arduino is only a, Arduino is not actually a, any device. Arduino is only a company. Okay. There are different versions of Arduinos. Okay. So and Arduino has different kinds of boards. In the Arduino Uno is one kind of board which we generally use, which has a microcontroller called Atmega 328. So Atmega 328 is a microcontroller that is prevailing in Arduino. Arduino is only a motherboard which is facilitating Atmega 328. Like that Arduino 101 is there. Arduino 101 is a again a motherboard for your Intel Curie processor. Arduino 101 is a board for Intel Curie processor which has a Bluetooth connectivity like that. So Arduino is a company which manufactures boards for different microcontroller based boards. Okay. So basically we generally call Arduino, or it's what we mean by that is when you talk about Arduino, it's an Arduino Uno, okay, which is a microcontroller. Okay. And this works with 5 voltage and 3.3 volt, but generally all the outputs are 5 volt. Whereas in Raspberry Pi, it also has GPIO pins, the general purpose input output pins, which works with 3.3 volt. Okay. So basic difference is it's a microcontroller, Arduino is a microcontroller and a Raspberry Pi is a microprocessor. Cost, Arduino costs 400 rupees, whereas Raspberry Pi costs 4000 rupees. Okay. But when it comes to control, pin control, the current carrying capability, Arduino has more current carrying capability. Current carrying capability to the outside, or it can drive more outputs, okay, than that of a Raspberry Pi. The board will get damaged very easily if you use a Raspberry Pi directly to a motor control, whereas you can use a Arduino to control a motor directly. Okay. So it's always a better powerful combination to use Arduino plus Raspberry Pi. Okay. This is one combination which I always like, because now you have two things. Now you have the edge device or the end control by Arduino, and the analytics and the edge analytics can be done by your Raspberry Pi, and your Raspberry Pi has all connectivity within itself. Okay. Within itself. Now Arduino can have other development boards upon it so that it processes just like your Raspberry Pi. Main thing is your cost. You can go for Arduino and for the control actions. So always I prefer giving control actions from the Raspberry Pi to the Arduino, and the Arduino will be connected to your end devices or your actuators. Okay. That is a good combination to use. So your sensors. So I don't prefer connecting sensors directly to the Raspberry Pi also. Sensors and actuators you connected to your Arduino, and Arduino you connected to your Raspberry Pi for machine learning and for other purposes like your transmission to your LAN, Wi-Fi connectivity and all those things, you use your Arduino. Raspberry Pi only when you have subjects or when you have projects which really requires huge processing. When you want storage, and especially Arduino does not have any storage, you need to connect to an EEPROM or an SD card. But that will be much more, it cannot handle such power. The operating frequency for Arduino is 16 megahertz. Whereas your Raspberry Pi works with 1 gigahertz speed. So this is the operating frequency with Arduino and Raspberry Pi also, the operating frequency. So just imagine 1 gigahertz and you have around 2 GB RAM. Whereas your Arduino has only a RAM of very minimal size. 8 GB of RAM only it has. So can you imagine the RAM size and such things? It's a computer. So as ma'am was saying, it's a full-fledged computer only, Raspberry Pi. You do not require for every application a full-fledged computer. And when you want to deploy, say, for example, 10 different parts, you need to connect sensors. You cannot connect 10 different Raspberry Pis. Going to expenditure is going to 10 Raspberry Pis is going to cost 40,000 rupees. Whereas in 4,000 rupees, you can always save and you can install a lot of sensors and you can connect a lot of microcontroller boards in different places. Okay, so at the end of the day, what you have is a very cost-effective things you can do with microprocessor, microcontrollers. When you want a good amount of processing to be done, you connect one Raspberry Pi and do the machine learning part. Whenever you want to do machine learning and all those things, you put Raspberry Pi over there. So that you can minimize the cloud connectivity also. Only when you require, you connect to the cloud and or you store it to a database or a web interface. One second, just wait a minute. No, I just muted my mic for a moment, that's why. Hello? Yes. So now you can ask your questions. I am ready to answer I am available for a few more. So if you want, you can ask doubts regarding any research works you need to take forward in this, you can ask.
So coming to the security aspect,
yes, sir.
Which is the best way, whether I should go with LoRa, I should go with Wi-Fi, or I should go with Bluetooth?
Sir, see, when you told about these three things, each one has their own security features, but the ranges are different. See, you cannot use in an application where you are using Bluetooth, is for low range connectivity. So the question comes over there also with the distance in which you need to transmit data also. See, if you have an edge device, I will suggest you can directly go with the Wi-Fi connectivity itself. Wi-Fi. Because all the other security features are taken care by your transport layer and all those security itself is being covered up, correct?
Yes.
When you use Wi-Fi, you already have a very good security layer which has already been defined. So you can, it depends on the, again, I'll tell you, sir, it depends on the application that you are using.
We have got a Metasploit software which can try to hatch, Wi-Fi networks.
Yeah. So that's what Wi-Fi networks are hackable. I'm telling you again, Internet of Things itself is hackable. In that mode.
Yeah.
Correct.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Ha, sir, this is Gajendra Singh Mori.
Yes, sir, please, sir.
From Mandvi Education Society, Gujarat.
Yes, sir.
My question is, actually I want to get a DHT11 sensors data on local server. And then I want to apply ontology on it.
Okay.
So how it possible? Means my first target is I want to get DHT11 sensors data on my local server.
That's a temperature sensor, right?
Yes, yes, temperature and humidity sensor.
So that's a temperature and humidity sensor. Yeah, fine.
Yes, yes, I need to get data first on a local server.
Huh.
And then after, I want to apply ontology. Means, yes, I want to achieve semantics.
So you don't want to apply it on your local. You need to obtain the data on the local, correct? So what you can do is that you can connect it to the
that I did it, sir. Sir, I got the data on a local server, but now I want to apply ontology on it.
Huh.
So my question is, can we get these data in the form of JSON or XML format?
Yes, sir. So if you're taking it into a Raspberry Pi, okay.
Yes.
If you're taking it into Raspberry, you can directly.
I am using a ESP8266 node MCU.
It's a Wi-Fi connected, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So Wi-Fi, you take it to a Firebase server then. Okay.
No. Actually, I'm using local server, sir. Local host.
Local host. Oh, to your computer you're getting, right?
Yes, yes.
So if you're getting to a computer, just write a Python script in order to convert that into JSON on XML. That's it. Take it as a variable.
But this data is coming on a web page.
Huh. So web page, but it has a DB, right? It is stored in the database, right, first?
No. I'm getting direct data on a web page.
Okay, but the source? So then
you
can directly convert, you are using an Arduino or Node MCU itself, you can write a code to convert that into JSON.
Okay, sir. Actually, Node MCU, the code is a combination of programming C and HTML in a single file.
Okay.
And getting data direct, I mean, the flow like that, like this, sensors data getting on a ESP8266 Node MCU, and this data will be displayed on a serial monitor.
Okay.
And here in the serial monitor, it generates one IP address.
Huh.
And I just direct copy and paste this IP address on the browsers.
Hmm.
And I get data on the browsers.
Okay.
But so I want to apply semantic before displaying data.
So I will suggest you to use a Raspberry Pi in between to that, do all these analytics into that. So what I'll suggest is if you're taking the data, send through the serial port to the Raspberry Pi.
Okay, sir.
So what happens is that the advantage is that now you can apply Python machine learning into that. You can apply NLP into it. You can apply any algorithms that you require on that thing. And then you can display it to the web server because now you have a computer working on it itself.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'll suggest you to go into, when you want to do such kind of things in between, you always use a Raspberry Pi to do it. So Raspberry Pi is not the only option, okay? There is something called as BeagleBone Black, which I showed you. Everything has a Linux operating system in that. Raspberry Pi is much more convenient.
Yes, sir.
One more few questions has been asked. Can we consider the data?
Thank you, sir.
Yes, please. No problem. Session going on. Can we, Ramchandra, can we consider the data collected by sensors as sensitive data? That depends on application. For example, medical data, you can consider, you can provide, write separate protocols to define, sensitivity and all those things. You can do separate research on that. You can write, work with edge computing concepts. You can come up with protocols which considers sensitive data in a separate manner. All these things can be done. So it is up to us to define what is this. It requires domain expertise to define what is sensitive data initially. And once you define that, those informations can be pushed on to your knowledge base. And as and when the data is coming, you can activate certain flag points to tell that this is sensitive data and things like that. Things to do a project on smart irrigation system using application that is created by us. Please provide complete details on this. Smart irrigation. Smart irrigation. Now that's what, when you have a problem domain, maybe I can take your, if you want to go much more detailed information, I can take it personally also. If you want, I can just say a few minutes. What are the, first of all, find out the problem statement. what are the things that you should measure for a smart irrigation? In irrigation, what are the things that are being considered? Water flow, humidity, temperature, soil pH, then water level in the field, water flow. So there are a lot of things that has to be measured. So for that, what all sensors are required, you need to put a list. Now you need to measure what are the range in which the values change. Based upon that, you need to buy the sensors. Then you need to attach, collect those sensor values, whether you need to have a wireless sensor to be connected or wired sensor contained in one particular point and then transmit it to a different location. Then you require, so for cloud and storage, you have a lot of things. You can use a normal computer itself as of now. When you use a Raspberry Pi, you can complete the system. Or else you go for ThingSpeak or ThingsWork, or you go with other cloud platforms where you have default analytics that you can apply directly on it. Okay. So if you want in detail, you can mail me or WhatsApp me, and we can discuss on those aspects. Sir, in a repository, Karthikeyan sir is from, sir, any repository for collecting IoT based data related to solar, wastewater treatment. Okay. So wastewater treatment, I don't have. For water, there are some Australian websites which provides water based data. For solar radiance data is also available.
Sir, I have gathered a lot of data regarding to this. I just share that links in the chat window, sir. Even my hobby is collecting all the, I'm data scientist enthusiast, so I have collected. Okay. I will share right now, sir. I have.
Yes, ma'am. If you can share it with me also, it'll be like.
Yeah, sure, sir.
If you have a Google Drive link also, you can please share it.
One Word document I'm having, sir. Okay. That I will share, sir, one word, because many are in the form of picture. I cropped it and I maintain.
Okay.
I am sharing right now, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Please share it in this chat.
With you personally, I will communicate and I will share with you, sir.
Okay, ma'am. This thing
for you, sir. That entire file itself, I will share, sir.
Okay, ma'am. I will share one document for you people, just for link for some of the sensors I can share.
There is another set of link related to Arduino projects. It means IoT projects repository, like Kaggle is meant for machine learning. These are all the repositories meant for IoT related projects. That two links I have shared. You please make a note of it.
Yes, ma'am. I'll make a note of that.
No, sir. Not for you participants. I'm telling, sir. I will send you the document itself, sir.
Okay.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah. Hello.
Hello. Ma'am, please, can you share this in a WhatsApp group also?
Yeah, yeah. Then I will share with you, sir.
Okay.
So I will tell you people, like I don't personally encourage people working on data directly. Okay, because what happens is that we have people sharing data with us, and it's easy to work with data, but if you really want to see how the data is generated, you need to buy sensors and see exactly how that sensor is functioning, what is the value it is giving. So if you are able to do that, I think so that will give you people a very good feeling of how exactly this data was generated. You always see a lot of CSVs coming up, but how that CSV was generated? Generating that CSV is the most important part. And if you see CSVs being generated by yourself, I think so we should, we'll go with such kind of things are very useful. And I'm happy that a lot of people from different universities around India is participating. And that is only possible when you have online webinars or workshops. But when you want exactly the hands-on and things like that, direct college interaction is a very important aspect. Face-to-face interactions, you get a lot of connected and you will learn a lot by learn by mistakes only. And all things cannot be learned in a day. That is one more thing. And because this is a IoT is a system where not only software works, hardware, wireless communication and software together plays important roles. So I think getting the correct values is important. So kindly please work on sensors. Take sensors, find different sensors and try out and see. And anytime you have any doubts also, you can ask. That's all. That will, I will be very happy to help you people in that.
sir. Shall we conclude, sir? Afternoon session is really your session. Everyone have got energized. That is the way I can say. However, every resource person contributed in knowledge a lot, but you have energized along with knowledge. That is the speciality I found in you. So everyone actively participated. This is the first time I'm seeing this much bigger chat history. After this fourth day morning, bigger chat history after giving audio provision also. This is really amazing because that is the indication that they are all energized. That's why I'm using the word you have energized than knowledge. Everybody is enjoying. They are giving very good comments also, sir. And I will share the data links to the participants in the WhatsApp group also, all the materials repositories for you as well, sir.
Yes, so, ma'am. Because I am not there in the participant group.
Yes, sir. We will include you also. We will include you, sir.
I'll be happy to be a part of that.
Then we will include you, sir. In 5-10 minutes after the end of the session, we will include you also. Yeah.
No, because even if you people have doubts regarding publications, paper publications, and because I've been reviewing for a lot of journals and I can help you out whether the paper is
fantastic, sir.
To get through the publications and things like that. That's also possible.
If you are there is one more resource person, Indian IASC Bangalore. He is a research scholar. He already joined and he started communicating, sharing material. If you are there, we can take it forward with this team productively. Other than this workshop, this is coming and going. We can continue our journey. We can do something better constructively, sir.
Of course,
amazing. Ma'am. Your thought is amazing, sir.
My bachelor's is in instrumentation. My PhD master's is in wireless communication, my PhD is in computer science.
Yes, sir. Fine, sir. Fantastic combination. That's why I didn't even leave any part of your profile. All the projects which you have done, patents and your reviewer, every corner I have touched upon.
Even if you people want to file patents individually also, I can teach you people how to write patents and all those things is possible.
Thanks.
And those things are possible. Especially for computer science, it's a bit difficult to file a patent. So we can help you through in that aspects also.
Definitely I will be calling you, sir. I will be troubling you a lot. Itself I am getting excuse from you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
I have to thank Pichai sir also for inviting
me. Yes, sir. Pichai sir is here only. Just now we reached, he went for other official work away from this. I am host from the day one. I am working as a moderator and a host.
Okay.
So I will hand over to him, sir.
Yes, ma'am, please.
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir.
Sir, thank you for your nice presentation, sir.
Thanks a lot for inviting.
Actually, madam told about your presentation. Madam always mentioned about you energized the participants.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. If it was in the real mode, I would have done even much more better. If I see people in front of me,
that
connection is very, very important.
Yes, sir.
We don't see people. So anyway, thank you, sir.
We will call you in future also.
Thank you.
Actually, today we have missed another session. But anyway, we will call you, sir, in the recent future.
Most welcome. I'll be very happy to do it.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, sir.
Sir, really we will put you in our department IoT activities, sir. We have found one pearl, I can say. So that, nothing
pleasure,
to worry.
Ma'am.
Yes, definitely we will be inviting. Nowadays, virtual itself works well. So that no need to travel also, no need to come to Hyderabad. Be comfortable at Bangalore. We will be inviting you. Have a nice lunch, sir. Have a nice day. Really amazing. The way... that interaction, people have got small spark doubts that need to be clarified. That is where you were novelty I have seen today. The doubt clarification was awesome. Thank you for that your approach everything you have cleared with the patience and with the clarity.
Yes, sir. I'm ready to clear anytime people can ask any doubts. Be happy to do it.
Definitely, sir. Thanks a lot. Have a nice lunch, sir. Have a nice day. We will be definitely looking forward with your association in our institution or for department. So I thank you all participants for your active participation. Today I could see lot of message flooding in the chat box. Constructive message. Today that I can say constructive message. Have a nice lunch. Let us meet again by 2 o'clock exactly. There is another session on IoT robotics arm. So robotic arm IoT. This is what the concept after more we will be discussing. Thank you all. You can all leave the session. Have a wonderful lunch.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.